Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2023. Before we begin our proceedings this morning, I'd like to welcome our new clerk, Jyoti Chandola, who's joining us. And in so doing, I would like to thank very much Andrew Milne, who's acted as clerk to the committee during the course of the last year. Obviously, stepping in for Lynn Tullis, who we still hope to see back with us in early course, but Andrew did a fantastic job, and I don't want to place on record my thanks and the thanks of the committee for everything you did, particularly supporting us through the recently completed inquiry, which will of course be the subject of a debate in the chamber later this week. Colleagues, the first item on the agenda is to agree to take decisions in private. In consideration to petitions today, there are a number of related issues requiring our attention. Agenda item 5 relates to budget scrutiny. Agenda item 6 relates to the policy and the publication of previous actions in relation to information and petitions. And the final item, item 7, refers to the A9 dueling project inquiry, and it will give us an opportunity to consider, you know, where we go next, and also of the evidence that we heard from Alec Neil, our former colleague, at the last meeting. Are members content that we conduct these items in private?
Agreed.
Thank you. Item 2 this morning is the consideration of continued petitions. And we will be joined, I'm delighted to say, by our very good supporters and petition champions, Rhoda Grant, MSP, and Monica Lennon, MSP. And Rhoda Grant is here to join us in relation to the first of these continued petitions, petition number 1723, Essential Tremor Treatment in Scotland. This was lodged by Mary Ramsay and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to raise awareness of essential tremor and to support the introduction and use of a focus ultrasound scanner for treating people in Scotland who have this condition. In her written submission, the petitioner states that the current treatment for essential tremor, deep brain stimulation, costs a minimum of £30,000, while MRG FUS costs £10,000. 20 patients were treated in Dundee with MRG FUS over 18 months, with 14 of those patients being eligible for DBS but facing a 2.5-year waiting list. Now, the National Services Division has shared that it received an updated application from the lead consultant neurologist working within NHS Tayside for a new MRI-focused ultrasound functional neurosurgery service to treat patients with essential tremor. The NHS Tayside executive leadership team advised that they were supportive in principle of the application, but a paper outlining the proposal in detail had not yet been submitted for executive approval and so could not be progressed. NSD advised that an application should be resubmitted for consideration in 24-25. And this is the petition you're wishing. I knew that it would be. And I have to say, Rhoda, just before I ask you to speak, that I'm quite sympathetic to the petitioner's most recent submission, where she thinks that, as has been the case, although she doesn't put it this way, with other health-related issues, actually being able to present, those affected actually being able to present evidence to the committee can sometimes be quite a powerful additional stimulant in us seeking to progress the aims of the petition. But, Rhoda, over to you.
Mary Ramsay and others stand ready to present to the committee, and I think it would be powerful. Mary has had deep brain stimulation and is not eligible for the new treatment because of that, but there are others who are willing also to give evidence, so you'd see the contrast and hear the difference of experience that both have faced. I think it would be very powerful for the committee to hear that. This petition's been running for some time, so those that give evidence previously, it was a previous parliament and a previous committee, so it would be good for members of this committee to see that. So I would very much back Mary's proposal. I also wonder if the committee, really frustrating actually, because we thought we were there, we've got the machine in Scotland, there are health board applications to individual patient applications to get the treatment in Scotland, but we're still stalled at the forthcoming, a treatment that's available to all as par for the course. I don't totally understand what happened within NHS Tayside. The stage one application was put in, but something delayed or stopped or prevented the stage two application going in. And I don't understand that, given the equipment and the staff are there already. So I wonder if the committee would also write to the chief executive of NHS Tayside just to find out what happened and whether they stand ready to put in a substantial application at the next round, which I understand is next year. And it might also be really helpful if the committee could write again to the National Services Division just to clarify the timescale for applications and when they would need it and what they require, so we're all clear as to what is required to get this as an NHS treatment in Scotland, like the rest of the UK. So those are two things that I would recommend, but I would back Mary Ramsay's offer for herself and others to give evidence to the committee, because I think that would be really helpful.
Colleagues, well, actually, can I say to Rhoda Grant that I think that the very actions that we were ourselves considering taking are the ones you have just proposed. So thank you very much for that suggestion. Are we happy to incorporate Rhoda Grant's suggestions in relation to NHS Tayside? I think we will hear what NHS Tayside have to do, but do that on the presumption that having heard what they have to say, that we may very well then seek to have the petitioner or others who have been affected by the condition potentially give evidence to the committee, so that we have that on record and, you know, it's there for everyone else to see as well, just what the condition has led to and the difficulties that they have had in trying to, you know, find a way forward. So are we content to proceed on that basis, colleagues? David Torrens?
Agreed.
Agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. Thank you. You came, you asked, you got. There we go.
I hope the rest of the day is like that.
Only government ministers were like that, eh? The second of our petitions this morning is petition number 1871, a full review of mental health services. This petition was lodged by Karen McEwen on behalf of Shining Lights for Change, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to carry out a full review of mental health services in Scotland to include the referral process, crisis support, risk assessments, safe plans, integrated services working together, first response support and the support available to families affected by suicide. Now, following our evidence session with the then Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, the committee has received additional details in relation to the suicide prevention strategy, such as information about the outcomes framework and the reporting cycle. Information about the mental health assessment units is provided in the submission. NHS Forth Valley, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, NHS Lothian and NHS Highland have dedicated units, whereas the remaining health boards have repurposed existing services or resources to provide 24/7 access to a senior clinical decision maker. And it's noted that the redesign of urgent care programme will work on improving the unplanned access to urgent assessment and care to provide support quickly at the first time, reaching out and where possible close to home. Now, the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport's recent submission indicates that the first annual report on the suicide prevention strategy outcomes will be published in July 2024. The petitioner has provided a written submission which once again urges the committee to call for a review of mental health services. She feels this is the only way to determine what is and is not working, and she shares concerns over mental health support falling to the third sector, expressing that this is not appropriate in all cases, particularly for people in crisis. So I do think there has been some reaction from the government in terms of how they have moved forward with the aims of the petition. We're joined by Monica Lennon, who's followed this petition with us through its various iterations. And Monica, is there anything you'd like to say to the committee before we consider our next move?
Good morning, convener and committee. Thank you for your ongoing work. It's been helpful to see the recent responses from the Scottish Government. Unfortunately, Karen McEwen isn't able to be here in person today, but her plea is to keep this open and to not close the petition, because in her view, and I think many of my constituents feel the same way, that the situation out there on the front line and in communities is getting worse, not better. So I think we all would welcome the Scottish Government's ongoing interest and commitment. But these strategies and frameworks, as they often are very high level and are fueled by good intentions. But I'm afraid we're seeing an ongoing disconnect, because the resources that we need in our communities for our health services and for local government as well, that has a role to play, and indeed the third sector, the capacity isn't there. The training is not being kept up to date, and we have a workforce that is burnt out also. You know, I'm struck by some of Karen's words in one of her submissions, when she talks about the time when her partner Luke was in crisis before he died by suicide. And she talks about the really hard time that she had trying to keep him safe. So it's the impact on family, friends, colleagues. I feel, given where we've been in the last few years, you know, Luke died at the end of 2017, but since then we've had the pandemic and the impact of that on our citizens in Scotland. Coming through that, people have then had to deal with and cope with the cost of living crisis, and our public services are on their knees like never before. So what I think really needs to happen is a real deep dive into mental health services to understand why so many people are getting to crisis point, and why all the good intentions around prevention, why that's not working well enough. I think some of the voices that could help inform that, of course, people with direct experience who've been in crisis themselves or have lost loved ones to suicide, to hear more directly from those who are on the front line. I don't mean, you know, and with respect, I don't mean the chief executives and senior people at board level. I mean those people in teams who have caseloads that simply make your eyes water. And I think also the police. I think Police Scotland have a big story to tell here, because often when our constituents are in crisis, it's the police who are called. It's police officers in uniform who come to the door, and they provide a really important service as well. But I think that's another sign that the services are not working. Just to bring it back to a human level, you know, and I'm sure this is familiar to all the members on the committee. You know, we just, and one life lost to suicide is of course one too many, but we just hear too many tragic cases in our own areas where people have lost their lives. Increasingly, every time I go into my local Facebook groups, I'm seeing neighbours in my community crowdfunding to cover funeral costs for people who've lost their lives and have left families behind. And I worry about the impact on those children and those loved ones who are left behind. There's so much trauma being stored up. So, again, I want to pay tribute to Karen McKeown. I know from the government submissions, they are grateful to Karen for bringing this petition. I know that when the former Cabinet Secretary, who's now our First Minister, was here, and I've had discussions with him, he was very moved by Karen's, not just her experience, but her commitment to ensure that we can prevent suicides and that we can prevent other families from going through this pain and suffering. So I think there's more work to be done. I'm pleased that the government is committed to do further monitoring and to do what they can. But these problems in the health service and in society started before the pandemic. We need to be having quite often difficult to hear conversations with people who are on the front line working in every part of the NHS. And I think I've mentioned Police Scotland, but I think social work also have important stories to share. And not just stories, but solutions. This is about trying to find solutions, because we know that for people experiencing poor mental health, there is still a lot of stigma out there. We know that that interfaces with substance use issues as well. And these are issues that parliamentarians care a lot about. So again, I'll just bring my remarks to a close there. I really do appreciate, because I know this has been on your books for quite some time, but I know Karen and the many people and groups that she's in contact with appreciate it. And as we've seen, the experience can differ across the country. We have different models of care, which is appropriate if it's meeting local needs, but too often people feel like they're falling through the cracks of a broken system that can vary to, you know, based on a sort of postcode lottery across Scotland. But yeah, thank you again for allowing me to say a few words on behalf of Karen and my other constituents who have a deep interest in this.
Thank you very much, Monica. And thank you too to Karen McKeown, and our best wishes to her. This is a petition that we've been looking at since 2021. Colleagues, I mean, I don't know what thoughts and comments colleagues have. I mean, David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider to writing to the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport to ask how the mental health assessment units in NHS Forth Valley, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, NHS Lothian and NHS Highland have been evaluated and how the lessons learned have been implemented across the health boards. And I wonder if we could also ask the Minister to set out in detail the journeys for individuals seeking support during mental health and crisis in areas with mental health assessment units and in areas with repurposed existing services for comparative purposes. In particular, providing information about each step in the process from seeking support to receiving appropriate care under both approaches.
Are we content? I mean, I think, colleagues, there may come a point where, in order to advance the aims of the petition, it might be that we ask the Health Committee to look at where the petition might go after a certain point. But I think we write as suggested in the first instance, keep the petition open, write as suggested in the first instance, see what that response is, and then consider what we think the best way forward to try and secure the aims of the petition would be after that. So thank you all very much, and thank you very much, Monica. That brings us to petition number 1885, make offering community shared ownership mandatory for all wind farm development planning processes. This has been lodged by Karen Murphy, calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to make community shared ownership a mandatory requirement to be offered as part of all planning proposals for wind farm development. And we've now received a response from the Scottish National Investment Bank, which states that it's been working with the Scottish Government and Local Energy Scotland while engaging with communities and developers on shared ownership. Local Energy Scotland conducted research in relation to developer and funder appetite for shared ownership models and ways in which barriers can be overcome. Now, the Minister for Energy's submission to the committee highlights that the Scottish Government would be interested in exploring the possibilities of utilising tax powers as a lever to support wider policy objectives. In response, the petitioner notes that there is no indication on how discussions on the Scottish Government's work will take place or how she and others might engage. So, some interest from the Government in relation to all of this. Members for comments and suggestions. Fergus Ewing.
Just a few suggestions, if I may. As the clerks have helpfully suggested, that perhaps we could write to the Minister for Energy and the Environment to ask whether the Scottish Government has the power to mandate community shared ownership for new wind farms by A, using the devolved power under Section 36 of the Electricity Act 1989 to lower the threshold for when an application to build a wind farm requires Minister's consent, and B, withholding consent from any application that did not agree to community shared ownership model. So that's the first suggestion. I wanted to make another suggestion or extended comment, if I may, Convener, just rereading the submissions that we've got. The Scottish National Investment Bank submission was dated 13th of March, which is a long time ago now, and the Minister gave a submission of the 6th of April. Both were quite helpful. Both referred to the work that Local Energy Scotland is doing, to which you have alluded, and both said that they expected to hear from Local Energy in the coming weeks, was the phrase, which was obviously used by both Minister and SNIB. Well, weeks have come and gone, months have elapsed since then, and if I could just take one example, I spoke to a wind farm developer who's proposing to develop a fairly large wind farm in the Dava area of my constituency, which is already covered with wind farms, and where there's a mixed view amongst the populace. But initially they wanted 50 turbines, and they're now down to 18, mainly because the park has negotiated it down to that. I have long thought that a way in which the community ownership can be made to work without it being seen as a penalty on commercial companies is that instead of 18, they go for 20 or 22, and the additional two or four be community owned. In other words, the company gets what it was planning to get anyway, but as in exchange for getting planning permission, they're required to give to enable the development to be expanded so that the communities can add two or four. And in those distant days of yore when I was the minister, there was funding available for this to be facilitated, and Triodos, Close Brothers, the co-op and some others funded this to the tune of 90-95%, and the Scottish Government funded the remaining 5-10%, and that allowed communities to have a real stake of ownership. And my worry is that time is passing by. These applications are going on all the time. Everyone that is granted is a lost opportunity. And the petitioner, Karen Murphy, has pointed that out, that, you know, that there are lots of applications for onshore going on all the time. And therefore, you know, I really wonder if we couldn't ask the Minister and SNIB to show a little bit more urgency, to tell us what Local Energy Scotland has said, as they promised they would do within a few weeks of their submissions, which they haven't done. And generally to kind of knock them out of this somewhat complacent approach when the real opportunities to Scotland, as everybody sees, I don't think as political convener, are being passed by. We're losing them. We used to grab them. There's a long history to this, and I've probably gone on for long enough, so I won't even go to chapter one of that long history. You'd be relieved to hear.
That was just the prologue.
Well, indeed, yeah, the preface to the prologue. But you know, I do feel very strongly that actually this could transform rural Scotland by providing not just £5,000 per megawatt, which is looking a bit jaded and out of date now itself, but also a real ownership stake. And that's when, you know, when the real opportunities to transform rural Scotland would arise, and particularly to invest in young people's training and education and future, using the fund for that purpose. So I just thought to make these remarks might help the minister see that opportunity knocks, but then the postman goes on to the next house, and that's in danger of what's happening here, I think.
Well, with that metaphor ringing the postman never knocks twice. Is that the
different kind of movie?
In which case, with that very entertaining polemic, might we are we content to embrace the suggestions of? And I think I actually quite like the idea that we do encapsulate in the further inquiries we're making the point about missed opportunity, because, you know, for every, I mean, this petition has been with us now since, when was it first lodged? August 21. So, I mean, you know, in, we've gone 2 years, and I think Mr. Ewing's point about applications being granted but there's been nothing happened means, you know, that's 2 years of lost opportunity, and so we should, there we go.
A few other things, you know.
Any other suggestions? Are we content to agree with that? Well, petition number 1968, restrict perpetrators of domestic abuse from using family court proceedings to continue tormenting their victims. And this was lodged by Angela Evans, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review existing legislation and family law and seek to stop perpetrators of domestic abuse causing further abuse and distress to partners and children by removing their ability to apply for contact orders under Section 11 of the Children's Scotland Act 2020. Now, we previously considered this petition at our meeting on the 8th of February, and at that time we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, the Law Society of Scotland, Scottish Women's Aid, Shared Parenting Scotland, and the Children and Young People's Commissioner. And copies of the responses that we've received are in our meeting papers. The Minister for Community Safety's response, which was submitted in March, provides details on the work underway to commence the various provisions of the Children's Scotland Act 2020, with measures to regulate the provision of child contact centres expected to be introduced later in 2023. Then the then Minister also highlighted budgetary pressures in taking forward this work, noting that establishing a register of child welfare reporters may cost around £5 million a year. The responses from Shared Parenting Scotland, Scottish Women's Aid and the Children and Young People's Commissioner all noted concern about the slow progress being made to implement the 2020 Act, with the Children and Young People's Commissioner Scotland calling on the government to make funding available to progress implementation. Shared Parenting Scotland suggested that more detailed statistical information on child contact cases should be recorded by the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service in order to establish information about what happens in these cases. And Scottish Women's Aid also shared concerns that no routine data is available on courts' practices and outcomes in relation to disputed child contact cases in Scotland, emphasising that it's not possible to monitor the implementation of children's rights without this data. Now, we've also received a submission from the Law Society of Scotland, and it notes that appropriate and sensitive procedural rules should address concerns that family courts can be traumatising experience for victims of domestic abuse, with judicial training a vital component in ensuring practitioners and the court can respond to the particular circumstances of each case. And this response also notes the view of the Child and Family Law Subcommittee that there is already a solid framework in law that regard must be given in circumstances where there has been domestic abuse, and a full suite of powers is available to judges to deal with these matters. Colleagues, do we have any thoughts? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Children in Scotland Act 2020 contains measures designed to improve the position of families affected by domestic abuse, with measures to regulate the provision of child contact centres expected to be introduced in 2023. And the Law Society of Scotland considers there is already solid framework in the law that regard must be given to in the circumstances where there has been domestic abuse, with a full suite of powers available to judges to deal with these matters and early on in the proceedings.
Obviously 2023 is fast disappearing and nothing's yet materialised, but are we content to close the petition?
If we could highlight to petitioners, but then we could bring a petition. If they're not happy, we could bring a petition in a year's time.
I think that would be sensible, yeah. Because, a number of things, I think, are being suggested as in train. And, sometimes we leave petitions open just to see whether they materialise. I think if we close the petition on this account, we make clear that it would be possible to bring it back if they don't. OK, can I thank the petitioner very much for bringing this petition to our attention? And, action has been promised. We'll have to see whether that action is forthcoming. The petition number 1981 to ensure perpetrators of domestic abuse who have been excluded from the matrimonial home cannot force the sale of the property. Now, this is obviously continuing a theme that we've just been discussing, and is a petition that's been lodged by Carolyn Gourley. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to strengthen legislation to stop perpetrators of domestic abuse who have been excluded from the matrimonial home by a court order being able to cause further trauma and distress to their victims by trying to force the sale of the property. We last considered this also on the 8th of February, and members will note from our papers we've received responses from the Scottish Law Commission, which indicates this issue is one of the topics being considered as it determines the scope of review of civil remedies available for domestic abuse, and also from the Shared Parenting Scotland, who suggests that the Scottish Government could provide better public information on what communications are covered by exclusion orders. The response goes on to note that in the case of child contact arrangements, third-party contact is likely to be in the interests of the child, so long as the person or agency issuing the communication is doing it in a professional and non-threatening manner. The Law Society of Scotland response notes that interdicts can last for lengthy periods of time, and there is a difficult balance to strike between the rights of a property owner and the rights of a victim of domestic abuse to be protected from their abuser. The Society therefore considered that a blanket position would not be appropriate, and again stressed the importance of training for lawyers handling cases involving domestic abuse. Now, linked to its view on Petition 1968, the Society's Child and Family Law Subcommittee view is there is already a solid framework in the law that regard must be given in circumstances where there has been domestic abuse, and a full suite of powers is available to judges to deal with these matters. So I feel we're in a sort of similar position. Do colleagues have any suggestions? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would also consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government have no plans to reform Matrimonial Home Family Protection, Scotland Act 1981, and the Scottish Law Commission are currently focusing on a review of a law of civil remedies for domestic abuse, with consultation document expected in the first half of 2024. And the Law Society of Scotland considered there is already a solid framework in the law that regard must be given in the circumstances where there has been domestic abuse, with full suite of powers available to judges to deal with these matters early on in the proceedings. I wonder if we could also write to the Scottish Government recommending better public information to be provided on what is covered by exclusion orders and other related legal communications.
Even while we close the petition, yeah, doing
yes.
that, yeah.
Yes.
Fair enough. Colleagues, are we agreed? I mean, were you agreeing, Fergus?
I was just going to make an additional suggestion.
Of course.
I can see the logic of the replies from the Commission and the Law Society that this is a very difficult area and a blanket solution doesn't necessarily present itself. I do note, and this is a suggestion I've got, that the Law Commission say that in their 11th programme, which has not yet been published, they expect that aspects of family law, including issues relating to how family law intersects with domestic abuse and violence and so on, this should be covered between 23 and 27. I wonder if it would not be indecorous or impolite for us to recommend to the Commission that they perhaps try and focus that early on in their consideration, because, you know, on the face of it, a man who carries out violence and who's got a sole title to the matrimonial home is in a position of kind of, if you like, benefiting from his crime to the extent of being able to derive to sell property in certain circumstances. Anyways, interdicts may apply, but. But I just wondered whether members felt that we could urge the Commission to bring forward consideration to the early part of January 23, because I do think that this is an area where the Law Commission's advice is really going to be pretty essential, because they have provided family law in Scotland with a very solid base from the Family Law Scotland Act 85 onward, which I think has served Scotland well. But there are still loopholes to be filled, and I'm just making this plea really directly to them. And if we were to write to them, I don't see it would do any harm. And it might give the petitioner some comfort that we're not just kicking into the long grass.
I think we could do that in closing the petition, is make that suggestion as Mr Ewing has recommended. And together with Mr Torrance's suggestions, are we content to close the petition? Again, an important matter that's been highlighted, but given the Scottish Government has no plans to actually amend legislation, I think that this is probably the most effective route that we can recommend, and so we will close the petition on that basis. Are we agreed? Yes. That brings us to petition number 1990, to introduce a Scottish Parliament question session for young people, introduced by Jordan Anderson, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to request the introduction of a monthly chamber session to allow young people to put questions to the First Minister and the Cabinet. Previous consideration, we agreed to write to key stakeholders and delegated authority to the convener to agree who those stakeholders might be. Spice has provided a list of possible stakeholders, which is noted in the clerk's note. However, since the petition was last considered, the committee has published its report, embedding citizens' participation into the work of the Parliament, which includes a response to the recommendations made by the citizens' panel. And colleagues, of course, will recall that there was one very similar to that of the petition. And recommendation 14 was to schedule specific time in the debating chamber for individual public questions to be asked. And as members will recall, we concluded, and I'm quoting from our own report, we do not support recommendation for a question time, which is part of formal parliamentary business, as we think it raises too many difficulties, both of practice and principle. Having said all that, we'd be willing to see the idea further explored if there is cross-party support for doing so. Now, the petitioner has provided a written support which shares his view that young people are becoming increasingly engaged in politics and need greater representation in politics. So having delegated authority to me previously, you now, because I wanted to bring it back, given our own inquiry into the subject matter, there are a number of people, stakeholders, that we could write to, as identified by the clerks: the Scottish Youth Parliament, the Children's Parliament, the National Union of Students, Who Cares Scotland, the Scottish Commissioner for People with Learning Disabilities, the Intercultural Youth Scotland, Children in Scotland, and Youth Link Scotland. And are we content to see what their view is of all of this ahead of what I understand will be a session of the Scottish Youth Parliament here at Holyrood potentially next year? And it may well be that that might be a route that we think, if there was sufficient interest in this, that we could potentially subsequently recommend as a way forward for the petition. So are we content to continue on that basis? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Considering the report and the recommendations in the report, I wonder if we could write to these stakeholders, specifically asking about alternative ways that they can engage with the Scottish Government outside parliamentary business?
Yes, I think that would make sense too. Thank you. Faisal Chowdhury.
Just to say that my daughter is a member of the Youth Parliament, but the question I was going to say is, can we increase the frequency which the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Youth Parliament hold joint sessions?
I don't think we've ever held a joint session. I think it's simply that the Scottish Parliament has provided the campus of the Scottish Parliament for the Scottish Youth Parliament to meet within the campus. And that proposal has... Well, I think that policy has been once a parliament. Are you suggesting we write to the corporate body to see whether they would...
Yeah, I consider a joint...
Has the Scottish Youth Parliament made that request itself?
Well, talking to the youth parliamentarians, I had a few meetings with them, and they did suggest that they want to have more engagement with the MSPs.
But could we write to the corporate body then, just drawing their attention to this this petition and saying that the committee would be interested if they've had any engagement with the Scottish Youth Parliament as to whether or not it might be possible to facilitate more regular sessions of the Parliament in Holyrood? Are you content with that?
Yeah,
thank you. That brings us to agenda item 3, consideration of new petitions. And as always, before considering the new petitions, I say to anybody who might be following our proceedings that before we consider a petition, the Parliament's Independent Research Unit, SPICE, are given an opportunity to brief colleagues. And we also write to the Scottish Government to get their initial thoughts on the petition, so that we are considering it with some understanding of the issues underpinning and the government's likely view. The first of these new petitions is petition number 2035 to recognise legal control of generalist predators as a conservation act. This has been lodged by Alex Hogg on behalf of the Scottish Gamekeepers Association and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to officially recognise legal control of abundant generalist predators as an act of conservation to help ground nesting birds in Scotland. The Scottish Government's response to the petition recognises that predator control is an important component of species conservation, alongside other techniques such as habitat management and translocation. In response, the petitioner has asked how the Scottish Government's response might be published for wider parliamentary record, stating that a bigger recognition would provide clarity to professionals carrying out legal control of generalist predators, and highlights a relevant example to demonstrate a lack of clarity for professionals. The submission explains that Nature Scot had recommended predator control as a number one measure to save Caper Cayley. However, a ministerial statement on the issue focused on habitat improvement and did not then mention predator control. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr Ewing.
Yes, I've read Alex Hogg's response to the Scottish Government response, which, although positive, was somewhat skeletal and said that predator control, general predators, was just a component alongside other things. The petitioner has, in his submission to us, pointed out that the minister actually has kind of contradicted what the government has said, in that she says the main elements are not predator control, they are well-managed restoration and expansion of the pine forest, which is not what Nature Scots Scientific Advisory Committee said. They said that predator control is essential, and it's not happening in Strathspey, and the capper is under threat of extinction. And journalists such as Magnus Linklater have championed this cause for a long time. My recommendation, without labouring the point and going on for forever, is that given the expertise and knowledge that is possessed within the ranks of the SGA, and Alex Hogg's seniority as the president, it would be useful to have a short evidence session where we give him the opportunity to say what he thinks should be done, because plainly he has got a huge amount to offer, all in the cause of preventing this capper from going to extinction, which every land manager, every farmer in my constituency for the last 25 years says is going to happen unless they start controlling the predators.
Right, we're content to have Mr. Hogg. It could take a little time. I wonder in the first instance, I mean, I'm happy to do that, so let's set that in place. Might we also just write to the minister who delivered the statement, just drawing the contradiction in what we understood to be Nature Scots' advice and the statement itself, and then allying that to the government's response in which they said that they value generalist predators, you know, as a way forward, because in practice the statement or the response from the minister kind of undermined awareness or confidence in that as a route, and just see what response we get, because I think it'd be helpful to have that even as we hear from Mr. Hawke. Petition number 2037. Sorry, are we happy to do that?
Agreed.
Yes, thank you. Petition number 2037, Improving Literacy Standards in Schools Through Research-Informed Reading Instruction, lodged by Anne Glenny. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide national guidance, support and professional learning for teachers in research-informed reading instruction, such as specifically systematic synthetic phonics, to ensure teacher training institutions train new teachers in research-informed reading instruction, specifically systematic synthetic phonics. Members will have noted that the petitioner submitted a similar petition, which was discussed by our predecessor committee last session, and it was then that petition referred to the Education Skills Committee. The petitioner was subsequently closed by the current Education, Children and Young People Committee on the basis that it had no plans to scrutinise initial training education. Additional details of the previous consideration, including, are in the SPICE briefing. Now, the Cabinet Secretary's response indicates that work is underway by Education Scotland to develop a range of new resources relating to early reading, with part of this work outlining how systemic phonics approaches form one aspect of the overall pedagogy for early reading. The response goes on to state it is the responsibility of the General Teaching Council for Scotland to ensure initial teacher education programmes expose student teachers to a range of pedagogies to teach literacy and reading instruction, and it is important that Scottish ministers respect the independence of institutions providing initial teacher education by not prescribing the detailed content of courses. Now, the Cabinet Secretary has, however, written to the Scottish Council of Deans of Education requesting an update on the current position of the initial teacher education in relation to teacher skills and confidence to support children's reading in primary schools. We've also received a submission from the petitioner, which welcomes the news that Education Scotland are working in new early reading materials, but expresses concern that decoding skills, and specifically information on systematic synthetic phonics, remain absent from current teacher training programmes. The petitioner has also shared details of studies indicating that newly qualified teachers lack confidence and working knowledge to teach reading and phonics. Few tongue twisters in there. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider writing to the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills to ask whether the update from the Scottish Council of Deans of Education has been received and for its contents to be shared with the committee. And I wonder if we could also write to the General Teaching Council of Scotland seeking its views on the actions called for in the petition, specifically whether it has any plans to update the requirements for initial teacher education programmes.
Thank you. Do colleagues have any other comments or suggestions? Are colleagues content to proceed? So we'll keep the petition open, thank our petitioner, and seek the further information as requested. And thank the petitioner for bringing this petition back to us, which is one of the routes that we, of course, offer to petitioners after due time and consideration. Petition number 2040, I believe, is the last of our new petitions to consider this morning, which is to increase funding to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service to prevent serious cuts to the service provided to the public. I think something of which there was a session in Parliament yesterday that members could attend. This has been lodged by Anthony McManus. The petitioner calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the annual budget provided to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and take action to prevent job losses and the removal of frontline fire appliances from fire stations across Scotland. The petitioner tells us he is a serving firefighter at one of the fire stations due to lose its dedicated height appliance. In the petitioner's view, the decision by Scottish Fire and Rescue to remove 10 frontline fire appliances fire stations across Scotland could lead to potentially disastrous consequences for the communities affected. The Scottish Government responded to the petition to state that it has supported the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service with year-on-year increases, including an increase of £14.4 million in this year's budget. The Scottish Government response goes on to note that operational decisions on the board and location, on the number and location of appliances, are entirely a matter for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service Board and the Chief Officer. It is, however, stated the decision to withdraw appliances is not all about cost savings and is intended to ensure full crews are available for the remaining operational appliances more of the time. The Scottish Government also indicated they have received assurances from SFRS that the decision to temporarily remove these appliances has not been taken quickly or lightly, and that a rigorous assessment of the impact of these changes, along with a full public consultation on the package of changes, will take place before any permanent changes to service provision are made. Members may be aware that the Scottish Fire and Rescue have provided written and oral evidence to the Criminal Justice Committee on this issue as part of their pre-budget scrutiny process. Well, colleagues, Fergus Ewing?
I just wonder if we should either inquire or whether the clerks can inform us now if the Criminal Justice Committee reached any conclusion. I mean, plainly, it has heard detailed evidence and we haven't, and that's narrated clearly in the material that is before us. But it's not clear what the Criminal Justice Committee are going to do about it. I mean, it may be that in their budget report, convener, they will make recommendations. Would it be prudent for us to make informal inquiries to see where matters stand with the Criminal Justice Committee? They've started to look at this in detail, so it doesn't seem appropriate that we duplicate that work. But on the other hand, our duty to the petitioners is to make sure that we don't prematurely close the petition when we don't quite know where its fate lies.
Yes, my hesitation in opening it up is I was similarly struck that I didn't want us to embark on a duplicatory chain of investigation, but at the other hand, I wasn't clear that the investigation to date was going to work in quite the way that the aims of the petitioner would be seeking. I understand that we're likely to see that in November next month, the Criminal Justice Committee's submission. So I think Mike might be right that the first instance is the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and the Fire Brigades Union, just to allow them to give their views on the aims of the petition to this committee, which we can then take into account when we next consider it along with that submission and decide whether we think there's thereafter further work that this committee could do in advancing the aims of the petition. David Torrens?
Convener, I would agree with you, because I think yesterday I was at the event held in Parliament and every MSP was given a briefing at the end of it. that's in their inbox, which is very comprehensive. I'm wondering if we're also writing to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and the Fire Brigades Union. The Chief Officer has a lot to do with this. I wonder if we could get direct from him his views on it, because he's been advising the government.
Yeah, I think we could ask specifically too for the views of the Chief Officer. But I mean, I know this is an issue of huge public interest, and I mean, since the petition was lodged, there has been a very high profile major fire in Ayr, and I think, as I recall, their height appliance was no longer in service and one had to be provided from Glasgow, and there were issues raised about all of that. So very much one of the issues that was raised within the petition itself. Mr. Chowdhury?
Yeah, I mean, I had a few meetings with some of the firefighters as well, but Chief Officer has been put into a situation where if they don't have enough funding, they've got to make some decisions as well. So that some of the time, it depends on the funding as well. So I think it is important. We need to find out.
Well, I mean, I think we will get some indication potentially of whether the scope of that's been incorporated into the evidence heard by the Criminal Justice Committee as well. So I think when we next consider it, we'll be in a better informed position, if colleagues are content. And with that, we conclude our public session, and we now move into private session, and our next meeting will therefore be on Wednesday, the 8th of November.